On behalf of Masheikh Hamza and the community for coming down all the way here from Click, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him and accept from him, inshallah ta'ala. May he make this talk beneficial for all of us. Inshallah, after the talk, we do have food outside for everyone and it's free. So please do make sure you stay for spring with your family, inshallah ta'ala. And also, as you know, next week, if you haven't heard yet, about the big convention that's happening next weekend, inshallah ta'ala, at Hilton Americas and downtown. And Film Fest is part of that, and Al-Maghrib is part of that. And we have tickets for that if you haven't registered online yet. So if you're interested, there are a few sisters and a few brothers who are selling tickets for that, inshallah ta'ala. Jazakum Allah khair, and I hope you enjoy.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. All praise due to Allah and His praise and blessings and peace be upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, his family, his companions, and his followers until the day of judgment. I bear witness that Allah is the only one worthy of worship, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is last and final messenger. My dear brothers and sisters, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the beginning of this session or this lecture to bless your steps and to bless our gathering and to make us among those who will receive, who will be showered with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy and Allah's forgiveness. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help all of us to benefit from what we're going to hear and what we're going to learn today, inshallah ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have created us in a very unique way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala خلق الإنسان في أحسن تقويم, in a very sophisticated way, in a very unique fashion. And it's perfect. And in you, there is so many things when you contemplate about it, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created it. It's amazing. Some of the things that even in you, you don't know much about. So you don't know even much about your own self. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْرُوحِ قُلِ الْرُوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. They're asking you about the concept of soul. And it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. No matter how much knowledge that you have, human beings, the amount of knowledge that you have is not much, is comparing to the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the knowledge out there, is just a small amount of knowledge. That's why rahimallahu Imam Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, when he said, al-ilmu thalathatu ashbar, al-ilm is three stages. Whoever entered the first stage became arrogant. And that's normal, very natural. You see people when they start learning the sharia, learning physics, learning medicine, whatever field of knowledge. In the beginning, you feel arrogant because you think you know everything. And he said, whoever entered the second stage, tawadha, humble himself or herself. قَالَ وَمَنْ دَخَلَ فِي شِبْرِهِ الثَّالِثِ عَلِمَ أَنَّهُ جَاهِلٌ. And whoever entered the third stage, realize his or her ignorance. Because you will be exposed to an amount of knowledge that you will know whatever you've been acquired all these years, comparing to what is out there. There is so much knowledge. There is so much knowledge out there. So I want you to imagine all the knowledge of all humanity together. Put them all together in one unit and compare that knowledge to the knowledge of the rest of the creation, to the knowledge that's out there, to the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's nothing. It's nothing. And all of these amazing things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have created in you, something we call it al-qalb, the heart. But I'm not here to talk about the muscles that push the blood in your body, even though it is a very unique thing in you. But the heart, the concept of the heart, which is strictly related to the concept of the soul. Basically, yes, the Prophet ﷺ pointed to his own heart, whereas our heart exists in our chest, but there is something unique about this heart. There is secrets about this heart. Even us, with all technology today, we're not familiar with it. It is the place where the iman, where the basically the faith, where the love, where the emotion, yes, it is, somebody would say, Sheikh, it is related to the brain. There is a certain area in the brain. And anyway, I'm not going to go into that debate because even the Muslim scholars debated over this long time ago. And they said, is it the aql? It is the heart. But the point is that Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, have referred to this feeling, to this iman, that it is related to the heart of the mu'min. To the heart of the mu'min. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that those who will survive in the Day of Judgment, those who Allah will accept in the Day of Judgment, those who will save themselves from the hellfire and from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's wrath and anger, those who will come in the Day of Judgment, إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Those who will come with a basically clean, pure heart. سَلِمَ مِنَ الشُّبُهَاتِ وَسَلِمَ مِنَ الشَّهَوَاتِ. It is a heart that basically pure from the desires and the lust and the evil feelings. And it is also pure and free from all the doubts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His religion and His messenger. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that those who will be saved in the Day of Judgment, He told us about them by saying, مَنْ خَشِيَ الرَّحْمَنَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَجَاءَ بِقَلْبٍ مُنِيبٍ. He will come in the Day of Judgment with qalb, it is munib. What does munib mean? Munib, it means a heart that will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time. A heart that's attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, attached to His religion, attached to what Allah loves. A heart disattached itself from what Allah dislikes. This heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also told us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala control your heart. Control your heart. As it's in Surah Al-Anfal. And this verse was explained by the Prophet ﷺ multiple times. For instance, the Prophet ﷺ, part of his dua, as an Imam Muslim reported in his Sahih, Allahumma ya musarrif al-qulub, sarrif qalbi ila ta'at. O Allah, the one who control the hearts, direct my heart towards you. So that means heart can be directed to other directions, can go towards other directions, can focus on other things, can be occupied with other things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said that Himself would want Allah to direct His heart towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-Hadith Muslim also, he said, إِنَّ الْقُلُوبَ بَيْنَ إِصْبَعَيْنِ قُصْبَعَيْنِ كَيْفَمَا شِئْ تَنْطِقْهَا بَيْنَ إِصْبَعَيْنِ مِنْ أَصَابِعِ الرَّحْمَنِ يُقَلِّبُهُمَا كَيْفَ يَشَاءُ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala control the hearts, and all the hearts of humanities are between two of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's fingers. That He control these hearts the way He wants. Some people say, the qalb. Linguistically was called qalb because it comes from the word what? Taqallub, changing. The qalb change. And as a matter of fact, that's not the linguistic, that's not the scholars of Arabic language. That is the master of the Arabic language who said that. فَقَدْ ثَبَتَ عَنْهُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ كَمَا فِي مُسْنَدِ الْإِمَامِ أَحْمَدِ أَنَّهُ قَالْ إِنَّمَا الْقَلْبُ سُمِّيَ قَلْبًا لِتَقَلُّبِهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Prophet himself defined what this word means, al-qalb. He said al-qalb was called qalb because it's constantly changing. It's like when you qallid, you know, when you roll things and you, that's changing. It's the constant move. It's in a constant move. In another hadith of Muslim Ibn Ahmad also, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, لَهُوَ أَشَدُّ تَقَلُّبًا مِنَ الْمَاءِ فِي الْقُدْرِ حِينَ غَرَيَانًا. It is like when you boil water, and it's the water is so boiling, what happened to the water? You see these bubbles and the water changing, you know, the cold goes up and down, and the water just keep up, basically moving. That's how the heart is inside your body. If that means anything to us, it means that our heart cannot stay and remain in one level. Your heart either going heading up or going down. It's very rare for the heart to heart that doesn't basically the heart, your heart will never pause. It's either going this way or that way. Sometimes it shoots up faster than other time, and sometimes you basically decline faster than other time. But it's in a constant move. And if this is the case, constant move. The only time your heart will stop moving up and down when it stops beating. When your heartbeat stops. At that time, when you die, your iman will stop. It's either going up or going down. If we can establish this fact, and everybody realize this, everybody should be so worried about his iman. Because if this is the case, the heart is like the Prophet said, it's like, you know, the boiling water? Every time you boil water for tea or coffee, or you stick in the electricity that, you know, electric machine that boil the water very quickly, and you hear the water and the bubbles, remember this. That's how your heart is. So I have to be constantly aware of my heart, where it's gone, which direction it's gone. Unfortunately, brothers and sisters, so many of us, we're taking our hearts for granted. For granted. يقول سفيان الثوري رحمه الله, which is سفيان الثوري, one of the great scholars. He said, قال للذنوب علي في عيني أهوى من التبن إنما أخشى على قلبي أخشى على قلبي. والصحابة يقول, يعني أحد التابعين يقول, أدركت من أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم 30 يخشون على أنفسهم النفاق. I have basically witnessed so many of over 30 companions. They all worry about their hearts. That hypocrisy, where is hypocrisy? It's in the heart. Can basically goes into the heart. They are worried about their heart to change. Sufyan al-Thawri said, I'm not worried about maybe this sin I committed. I'm always worried about my heart. What's the impact of these sins on my heart? How's my heart will change? Because as you heard, the way to survive in the day of judgment, the way the doors of the gate of the Jannah will be open for those who have that pure heart, that clean heart, that heart which is filled with iman and faith. فَوَيْلُ لِلْقَاسِيَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ مِنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. That's why these hearts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described as qasiya, solid, ثُمَّ قَسَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ. Your hearts became so solid, so hard, that it is harder than the rock. Aren't you worried that your heart will turn to that status? Can you feel that sometimes that your heart became, you know, even when you are praying, sometimes you feel like, you know what? I don't feel it. My heart is not that soft anymore. My action in the word of worship is just actions. It's like a picture without soul. I don't feel that closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever I raise my hand, I don't feel that I'm so close to Him, that I'm really, truly talking to Him and He's talking to me. I don't feel His presence.